Commissioner White. Commissioner White, your presence is requested up front, please.
Good evening, everybody. Now, can I get a motion to call this meeting into order? And it's been moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, this meeting is now in order. Our act of reverence. Let's see here. Sophie, why are you running up here? You know, I understand young people. Oh, wait, is that a young lady? Everybody looks young to me, as old as I am. No, in the purple violet coat. She looks young to me from here. Sit next to the guy with the green jacket. You, young lady, with the, you. You're looking at everybody else. You. You. Where do you go to school? You got to speak up. I can't hear you. 45. I'm sure at 45 they want you to speak up and enunciate, right? All right, so what I need you to do is speak up and enunciate and be very clear. We need somebody to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Would you be willing to do that? Yeah, sure you would. Come on, let's encourage her. Come on up here. Come on up here. Come on, come on, come on. Oh, we can let me. You can do it. You can do it. Come on. Come on up here. Yes, you can do it. Take this mic over here. We need someone to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Pretty straightforward. You've done it a few times, right? Oh, come on. More enthusiasm. Let's encourage her again. All right, here we go.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Let's give her another round of applause. We are so proud of our students at 45. Is a mom or dad or a relative with her? Who's that, dad? Grandfather. Let's give grandfather a round of applause. Thank you, Grandpa. Appreciate that. I know he was encouraging her to come on up here like I'm sure he encourages her in school, right? Amen. All right, here we go. We did the Pledge of Allegiance. That's item number one on our agenda, acceptance of the minutes. We have business meeting minutes from March 27th. April the 2nd, that was a special meeting, and April 22nd budget. I got a motion to move those minutes. Can I get a second? Those minutes have been moved and seconded. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
The ayes have it. Got that, Madam Clerk? Next item on the agenda, the Yes We Can Award. Now, I know Commissioner Cruz, you got this, right?
I got it.
He got it. So I'm going to just, okay, yes he can. Commissioner Cruz, it's on you, brother.
Yeah.
How are you?
Good evening.
Hey.
It's always an honor and an opportunity for us to recognize the greatness. Unfortunately, we spend some time thinking about the things that aren't. But there are so many great, positive things that are happening in our district. And frankly, we don't have the time to recognize all of those things and all those accomplishments of our students and our staff and our schools. But we're taking one opportunity tonight to give the Yes We Can Award. And I want to have the folks from the Leadership Academy of Young Men come up. If I can have them come up, please. Principal Wakili Moore, how are you, sir?
Good, how are you doing?
Okay, good. Yes, We Can Award. This evening, the board is recognizing the Leadership Academy for Young Men with a Yes, We Can Award for their extraordinary efforts in improving student attendance this school year. In an effort to improve attendance, among students, Principal Wakili Moore and his staff worked to closely monitor student attendance and made sure that students were involved and committed in their efforts. So far this year, you gotta love this, you gotta love this.
All right.
So far this year, attendance has improved from 72% to 87%. That's fantastic.
No, you didn't.
Let me repeat that. Shall I repeat that?
Yeah, repeat that, please.
You know what? I need to repeat that.
You do.
I do. From 9, from 72%.
All right, now.
This year.
72%.
To 87%. That's something that we need to recognize. We celebrate Principal Moore and his staff for working to motivate and engage students.
Thank you. All right. Speech.
So we have a certificate. It says Leadership Academy for Young Men by the Rochester Board of Education and Superintendent of Schools in recognition of exceptional improvement in student attendance given this 24th day of April 2014. Congratulations.
Okay. All right. Keep up the great work.
Speech.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Sinead told me I only had 30 seconds, so.
And she means it, too.
No, but this is an honor for us. I wish my staff could be here tonight, because it is a staff effort, not my effort. But it's been huge for us because, as you saw, 72% up to 87%. Our guys have been making choices over these 3 years, a choice to be with us or a choice to be replaced where they're not supposed to be. And we've been really emphasizing with them how important it is to be with us so we can give them opportunities down the road. So this is our work is not done. 87 is not our goal. We want it to be 100%. I know that sounds corny, but we really mean that. We want it to be 100%, and we're still pushing for that. So, again, thank you very much.
Okay, Commissioner Cruz?
Yes, sir.
That could be a permanent job, man. You like Jay Leno. Not Jay Leno. Who's
not
the current?
Jay Leno.
Thank you very much for doing that. Thank you, Beverly Burrell Moore, for tracking that kind of information, quality information, and providing it to the board. As you all can see, we removed those pictures that were up there for decades, and we replaced them with meaningful plaques, talking about Yes We Can and I Believe, and we're replacing them. You know what? We got it, Mr. Moore, are you still here? We got to make sure we have someone take a picture of you and your staff and maybe even some of your quality students who attend in school. And then that picture will place one of these symbols up here. So we're going to make sure someone takes it. Because you are, and your students are, the role model of excellence that will get this district to where we need to be. That we recognize progress, and you represent progress. Thank you again. Now, next item on the agenda is speakers addressing an agenda item. Let's begin with speakers addressing an agenda item. It's all very short list. Kimberly, thank you very much, ma'am. I apologize. I'm terrible at names. Come on up. I'm good. How are you?
Yes, indeed.
All right, Bohan Street, Bohan Street.
Okay, I believe the agenda tonight is addressing the pre-K program, if I'm correct, and I just want to just say some good things about the pre-K program. We have a daughter named Layla Rio that attends number 22 school, and just want to say how good it's been for her. She goes every day. Sometimes when we can't take her because we have work or whatever, she cries. She cries to us. So we have to kind of lie to her, unfortunately, and tell her, you know, school closed or whatever. But I'm not even lying because she will cry. My husband will attest to that. She will have a bad attitude all day. But I just want to let you know that these teachers are doing such a great job. Ms. Estenado, I can text her at 9 o'clock at night, whatever, and she calls me back or texts me as to what the progress is. I just hope that we keep this program here for these children and going forward, because I have more children that are going to come into the Rochester City School District, and I would love for them to come to Ms. Asenato and Ms. Ivy and be there. And then, you know, I just hope that everything, these programs continue, if not get more enhanced. I just heard that you guys got a very nice grant to help with this. I hope that you keep that intact. I hope you keep the person that brought that grant intact, because at this point she knows what it takes to get that. You want to hand it off to someone else, but I think that's too much workload for that person. I think this person has the charisma, the dedication for our students, and I believe that she should still keep her place so more children like my daughter Layla can cry to go to school, because that's what you want. You don't want them to be, oh God, here we go, going to school, I hate it. You know, every day she wakes up ready to go. She's up at 6 o'clock in the morning and she doesn't go till 11:30. So that goes to show that she has great teachers, and I just hope that we keep those great teachers, this great program, and also the woman that is helping to keep these programs great and make them even better within our system and in their places. Thank you.
Ron Key Tap. Tap it. Jeez, I'm terrible. You want to help me out with that? Make sure we get it. Ron K. Ron K. Okay. Last name is pronounced? Tap.
So, good evening, and thank you for allowing me to speak. My name is Dr. Ron K. Lattimore Tapp, and I am a parent of two, next year three, students at the Montessori Academy, school number 53. And I'm actually coming with a concern about the pre-K, not just the pre-K program, about the Montessori training of the teachers. We happen to come in, like I said, for 2 years now. So my oldest child, Rehani, is 4 years old, and much like the woman who just spoke, she loves school and wants to go all the time. In the summer when school ended, we had to tell her camp was school camp so that she wouldn't be upset about going. She started at Montessori with a teacher who was new and did not have the Montessori training. And also, because there was some sort of change in the agreement for teachers to be able to stay, we weren't even sure that her teacher was going to be able to stay. So I think the teacher was getting trained, but we weren't sure she'd have the same teacher. Turns out that this year she did have a different teacher, who's a new teacher who also does not have the Montessori training. My second child, Zakiya, started preschool three this year at Montessori. She's in a classroom with a teacher who does have that training now. The difference, I just recently had parent-teacher conferences and went to an event at the school where you go. They call it parent-child night. You go, the kids get to show you one of the lessons they're learning. You get to see what they're learning. The difference between what those two children are learning is, it blew me away and upset me. There is no way that my three-year-old should be further along than my four-year-old, simply because of the teacher's knowledge of the materials and ability to really notice what the child is excited about and encourage that. We do a lot of stuff at home. We have sight words up, for example, at home on the little board. Rehani, the four-year-old, is excited about that. She's learning words. Every time we come into school, she's trying to look at signs and find words. Whenever we go places, she's finding words. Zakiya, who's 3 years old in her class, has already been exposed to some of those and is learning some. She's been exposed to more than what we're doing at home. Rehani's teacher is just kind of like, well, you know, really they should start learning that around five, so she's okay. She's not. Part of the reason that we chose a Montessori education is because of the philosophy of it, the having different kids all together. If a three-year-old can do four-year-old math, they get exposed to four-year-old math. The teacher sees that, shows them the materials, they get to do that work. If a four-year-old is excited about sight words and different things, they get exposed to that. You notice that, you teach them, you start working with that. That is not happening. And it's not because it's not a good teacher. I think she cares a lot. She, you know, loves the children. She works well. She doesn't know that material and how to present it. And so at this point, myself, is that for my buzzer? At this point, myself, just being a parent from reading a homeschooling book, because we considered homeschool, and watching YouTube videos, I know more about the Montessori materials than her teacher does. Next year, if she leaves, I do not want my child to have to, again, have another new teacher who doesn't know Montessori. It is hurting her education, and I am concerned about that. We love Montessori. We chose public education both to support it and for Montessori. I want her to be able to get the benefit of a Montessori education. I do not want her to lose the school to lose funding or coaches or anything like that. We need that. Thank you.
Maurice Little. And I apologize for those who have not spoken before. We have a 3-minute time frame. One of the reasons why I should tell you all that we do the commissioners' cookies and conversations, not just because I have this weakness for cookies, but because the other board members and I determined that a lot of folks were frustrated with the 3-minute time frame and that we didn't respond, because that's not in our rules that allow us to answer questions and respond back. So we said, well, let's begin the meeting a half an hour earlier. Thanks to Commissioner Adams, we had a playlist today, and it included, I thought I heard, the soda song, right? A lot of local, yeah. So the music is playing in the background, there's cookies. It usually will happen every Thursday business meeting that we have at 6 o'clock. Tell your friends and family. So next one on the list is Maurice Little. Maurice Little. After Maurice Little, we have Jacqueline Katie. Thought I saw her here.
Hi, again. I think I should probably apologize for coming back so often. This evening, instead of talking about the budget, I want to talk about the curriculum. And I'm going to ask you to do something that I know is very difficult. I really want you to find, to create, to fund, to implement a curriculum for kindergarten to two that's best for the children. I spoke in the winter about the reaction of the children and teachers to engage New York to that curriculum. I and others cited examples of teachers frustrated, children turned off to learning. You know, the opposite of what these moms are talking about their children being excited to go to school in the morning. That's what we want. Specifically, the Engage New York curriculum is teacher-directed instead of child-centered, calls for large group activity instead of small group. It's scripted instead of responsive to children's interests. It offers unrealistically long lessons compared to the children's need for active learning and movement. Since that time in the winter, I and other early childhood supporters have had the opportunity to speak to the top reading and literacy faculty at Nazareth, U of R, St. John Fisher. Not one of these experienced experts in reading and literacy supports that Engage New York curriculum. Our two local New York regents agree that the Engage New York material should be used as a resource, not as the entire curriculum. In particular, in response to my question, Regent Brown added, the regents know the importance of the joy of learning. In other words, the joy of learning is not in the Engage New York curriculum. Let's give our students that joy of learning. I know, I have talked to all of you. I know the superintendent, I know the board members want to do what's best for children. Please call on these experts who know what a good curriculum would be for kindergarten to second grade and ask for their help and their expertise. A few years ago, the best K-2 teachers in the district were chosen to develop the Rochester curriculum for kindergarten to second grade. It was developmentally appropriate. It was culturally appropriate. It incorporated the Common Core. Katie Yarlett, who heads the grade 3 reading effort, was a leader in developing that Rochester curriculum. Can't we look to that curriculum, take the good elements that exist in Engage New York, and I understand there are many elements in Engage New York that are appropriate, get the help of these local experts, and insist on an appropriate curriculum and match it with strong professional development for our K-2 teachers and children. Thank you.
To items not addressing an agenda item, Felix Jacobs. I didn't see Felix here. Jamelia Glover. It's Glover. You know, you were back there with the cookies, and I was trying to have a conversation with somebody, and unfortunately, I don't think we had a chance to talk, so I apologize for that.
Well, I got my issue addressed, so thank you. Actually, what I was hoping to do was to be able to share a 32-second clip about my son, who is a senior at School.Walls. He was highlighted last night for Bright Spot of the Day. I don't know if any of you in the community have had a chance to see that. His name is Tajay Walker. As I mentioned, he's a senior at School.Walls. And since I can't show the clip, I'll just read to you guys what they pretty much said in the clip. So Wednesday's Bright Spot shines on high school senior with a sharp edge on the competition. The School.Walls requires every senior to complete a senior project before they graduate, and Tajay Walker decided to attend the Sharp Edges Barber Institute for his senior project. Yesterday, he and others from the school provided free haircuts for classmates and the community. When Tajay crosses the stage in June, he will have a high school diploma and a New York State Master's Barber license. So, yes, thank you. And I certainly appreciate that applause because I know that if Tajay had not attended school that was, he would not have succeeded the way that he has. Tajay has a unique learning style, very non-traditional, and I knew that the school that was would provide him with the structure that was beneficial for him. Traditionally, pen and paper is the way that we go to assess students and their abilities, whereas at the school that was, it's more performance-based. Such as his senior project, you know, he was able to get hands-on practical experience, you know, learning how to be a barber and to get a barber's license. I will also share with you all that Tajay's 19 and he'll be 20 in July, just graduating. So, you know, I do know that his chances for graduating decreased each year that he was older than the other students in his class. So I went out Tuesday and I supported him at his event, and I received a lot of positive feedback from the students, the teachers, you know, as far as the success of the project with Tajay and how many people it was able to reach, the extent that, you know, it was able to expand out to beyond the students and into the communities where people were able to come in and get a haircut for free. And so while I was there, you know, I spoke to the principal, Idonia Owens, and, you know, I just told her that, you know, without the structure of school that was, I know my son would not have made it to be a senior and to be graduating. I know that. And so, you know, I just told her I appreciate all that they do and how things are structured there. And, you know, she encouraged me to come tonight to speak and to share my story with you all, because from what I understand, they are having some issues with trying to figure out how to, you know, determine the success of the teachers. And so I think one thing that they're trying to do is implement paper and pen tests. I may not have my facts straight, but this is just what I got from the conversation. And I said, sure, I'll go out and share my son's success, because I know that it is because of the structure of this school my son has become so successful. So I just come here tonight to ask that you guys consider, you know, to keep things the way that they are for students like Tajay. He's had an IEP from the time he was in preschool. He had to go through speech classes. And I think just it was a grim beginning. We didn't think, you know, well, we never gave up hope on him, but we knew that it would be a hard road. But he went through with no problems at all and has succeeded, you know, on a very high level. And he gets positive feedback from everywhere, whether it be his community service projects, anything that he does, work, school. And so I attribute a lot of that to the School Without Walls. So please allow them to keep things the way they are.
You know, we heard you talk about your son and saying how hard he worked and how, and we applauded that and his success. And you talked about all the good things that they do at School Without Walls. But I would like us to give you a round of applause for sticking in there, hanging in there with your son. It's beautiful, absolutely beautiful. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Emma Fleming.
Still
you. Amen to that.
To the board, this time I'm going to come with what I came here for. The last time I didn't get a chance because I respect the board said we wouldn't get to 3 minutes, so what I had to say would take me at least 2 minutes, so I just avoided that and talked about something else. But I started out with President Bush with No Child Left Behind here. The reading program under Bishop Tillman. I went to 496 parent house by myself to bring these kids into the program. Bishop Tillman cheated me out of $3,500 out of my personal pocket because I wanted to see the kids learn how to read. if I had the opportunity to learn how to read when I was going to school, I would have 4 PhD, okay? That's just how reading is important to me. That's why I go out on the limb. And I was in a wreck in February the 10th of 1970, have not been paid. And for the last year, I have not been paid. And even under being sick, cancer, breath removed, it's ridiculous. But let me just say one thing. I started teaching in 1970. I never taught a student that I didn't know the parents. I went to the house. I called every parent. I gave them my phone number. Every parent could call me. From 6 to 7, they could call me because I taught every child like it was my own. And a lot of kids said, Grandmama, and they said, that's not your grandma. I said, yes, I'm her grandma. If she feel well enough to call me grandma, then I'm grandmama. And then somebody say something funny. I said, that's why you're not my grandchild, because all of my grandkids are smart. Just to make this clear, I got a 3.5-year-old grandson. He didn't realize I was a teacher. His granddad is a teacher. His mama is a teacher. He doesn't know that. But he told his mama, say, Mama, my teacher ain't teaching me nothing. 3.5. We need to go to school and talk to the teacher. So my daughter said she put it off. He said, Mama, we need to go to the school and talk to the teacher. They went to school, and you know how teachers be standing up at the door, you know, talking necessary. And he let her talk for a while. He hit on her butt. He said, Mama, we came up here to tell the teacher that she wasn't teaching me nothing. And that's why we up here. And everybody got so upset because, you know, it's strange for a 3.5-year-old to tell the teacher she ain't teaching him nothing. You see what I'm talking about? So I'm saying here, I had a problem with the superintendent because he's telling me that, you know, he volunteered because I was really getting upset. A principal out there, I mean, the superintendent going out to get kids to come to school, that's ridiculous. What are these principals doing? What are these teachers doing? They the one have the job, and they should make sure that these kids come to school. Amen?
Amen. Penny Carlson Palmer. Penny Carlson Palmer. Did I mangle that name too?
No.
I did. All right, thank you.
Thank you again for letting us all speak tonight. My name is Penny Carlson Palmer, and I'm here representing the Visual Arts Steering Committee. And we would like to share with you some of the exciting things we're doing in the art room and in the community. Before you in the brown paper bags, there is a gift. First grade students at school number 20 made you a present that will show you specifically how the arts connect to the general curriculum in the school and the study of world cultures.
Sorry.
Go ahead. Yep.
All right.
Okay.
Oh, wow. All right. Look at that. School time.
That's right.
Beautiful.
And there's a description of the project that goes along with that. Also, there's a copy of Magic Dragon, which is a magazine locally owned. It's a quarterly publication that highlights our students' work here in the city. So whenever you see an image that says Rochester, New York, next to the name, that's one of our kids. Okay.
Thank you.
And finally, I left you an invitation to the Charlotte Beach Family Event.
Got so many things up here.
I know,
like
we left
Christmas.
You live. We're going to try to start doing it every month. So keep you posted on everything that's happening.
You're talking about on May 17th?
Yep, May 17th. So we'll hope you'll come. The art department will have 2 tents. So we'll have a gallery tent set up with the students' artwork. And we're going to have a tent set up, an art activities tent. And that will have face painting and a craft. Music department will have an instrument petting zoo and a drum circle. We're hoping. We're still working out the details. But we've got a lot of fun activities planned. So bring your family, your kids, your grandkids, whoever. nieces, nephews. It's going to be a lot of fun. We hope to see you.
Thank you. That is the event that was put on last year by Jerome Underwood and Willie Robinson and the rest of your staff, Dr. Vargas. Well attended, was over 1,000 or something like that?
More than that.
Yeah, was it 2,000? It was 2,000, yep. So I wasn't able to go, but Malik, you went, didn't you?
I was there,
yeah. Yeah, it was packed.
A long time.
Yep. You went, Jose? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that is May the 17th from 11 to 4 p.m. at Charlotte Beach Park. So everyone, I assume that's going to be on our website, Shanae?
Yes.
Okay. All right, Mary Courtney and David Wirtz will follow Ms. Courtney.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
My name's Mary Courtney. I'm a teacher at Early College High School. You last saw me here 5 months ago on November 24th when I spoke to you regarding safety concerns for the students and staff at our building on Genesee Street. I detailed our concerns about the conditions outside our school and asked for your help to keep us safe. Unfortunately, things have gotten worse on Genesee since November. There have been 3 murders since then, literally within sight of our building on the one block between Samuel McCray and Frost. The latest incident was Tuesday afternoon this week when gunshots rang out directly across the street from our building around 1:30 in the afternoon. This is the exact same spot where I was caught in the midst of a gang beating. I told you about that in November. All of our students knew immediately it was gunshots. It was a chaotic situation outside with the victims driving away down the street, causing confusion about where the shooting actually happened. 30 minutes later, without any lockdown or lockout being issued, our school dismissed, sending hundreds of students out into the neighborhood. I watched out my third floor window in disbelief as our students left, just as RPD cruisers arrived, lights flashing, to start running crime tape around the shooting scene. Several minutes later, the doors opened again, and students as young as kindergarten from Wilson Foundation also streamed out into that scene. Tuesday evening, a robocall from the district notified us that our students were never in danger. I beg to differ. The students and staff at every school near Genesee Street were in danger Tuesday afternoon. We were in danger from stray bullets at the time of the shooting because bullets don't stop at property lines. We were in danger from a gunman who had not been caught. We were in danger inside the building, and then we put thousands of students at greater risk by sending them out into the midst of the confusion on Genesee Street. So I'm here today asking you, begging you, the Board of Education, to support us in our urgent request for an SRO to be stationed in our building to help keep our students safe. We as the school district cannot fix what's happening in the neighborhood, but recognizing the problems that exist in that area of the city, we have an ethical and moral obligation to do everything in our power to keep our kids safe in our schools. An SRO would provide stability, trained eyes and ears, and increased communication with RPD during dangerous situations, all of which could have helped in Tuesday's situation. Last week marked the 7th anniversary of my niece's senseless murder at Virginia Tech, when a gunman opened fire in her classroom on campus. Administrators at Tech had made the poor decision not to lock down the campus following the earlier shooting because they thought, even without a shooter in custody, that there was no danger to students on campus. They were dead wrong, and my niece paid the price with her life. I found it astounding that here we are 7 years later, still making the same mistakes and putting students at risk. On Tuesday, with the amount of confusion over where the shooting actually happened, with a gunman still loose in the neighborhood and an unsecured crime scene, no one will ever convince me that there was enough information to declare it safe for any school in that neighborhood to dismiss at regular time. So I ask you, if this type of unsafe environment would not be tolerated in Pittsford or Fairport or Penfield, why in God's name is it tolerated for our kids in RCSD? Please do the right thing. Support us in our third request this year for an SRO at our school. Or do we need to wait until a student is killed?
Ms. Courtney, do you have a copy of that statement?
Yes, I do.
Can you? I'll just give it to the clerk. Thank you very much. David Wirtz.
Dr. Vargas, members of the board, members of the community. My name is David Wurz. I've been a teacher for almost 30 years in the Rochester City School District, 22 at Frederick Douglass Middle School, 6 at School of the Arts, and the last 2 as a labor relations specialist for the Rochester Teachers Association. I'm here to advocate for a school resource officer, or SRO, to be permanently stationed at Wilson Foundation. Currently, there is none. What would an SRO or a student resource officer could they have prevented Tuesday? Well, for one, common sense tells me that SRO would have heard the gunshots just like our students did when they were hitting the floor and the teachers were saying, "Oh, it's going to be okay." And the student said, "No, you need to get down too, miss. Those are gunshots. I know what gunshots sound like." It's unfortunate that that particular lesson is well known by our students. But aside from that, an SRO would have heard the very same gunshots and ordered a lockdown of that building and prevented 1,100 students from streaming out of the building while they were still putting crime tape around near Kirkland or wherever the shooting was, very near the school. That would have definitely kept our students safer. Why is an SRO needed permanently for the future? To escort students who have, under Dr. Vargas's new initiative for extended learning, extended activities after school, the buses don't come to the loop like they do at dismissal. The city buses don't do that. The students have to walk down past the 4 corner stores where the adults are hanging out and loitering to arrive at the city bus to go home. I don't think this is a very safe situation. An SRO would also be able to break up those adults that are concentrating at the 4 corner stores by the school. Finally, an SRO would do probably the most important thing that we need to do, and that's give our students a sense of safety and security in that building, like we would in Brighton, in Pittsford, and Penfield, because without a sense of safety and security, all the educational initiative in the world will not work. We owe it to our students, and I am asking for common sense to prevail here, and tomorrow we need a student resource officer stationed at that school permanently. Thank you.
Regina Neary. Just to go back to the list, did Maurice Little appear? All right. That does it for our speakers for tonight. Superintendent's report. Dr. Vargas?
Well, thank you. I will, you have a copy of the PowerPoint that I will give you, which basically confirms the firm belief that I have that you would not improve graduation rate in this district unless you improve the early childhood education and our elementary school. As you can see, attendance is something that we track very carefully. The English language art test score, the math, the course credit at the high school level and GPA, and retention and suspension. Those are areas that could tell a lot about a population or a district, or about where we're going in the next years or year to come. As you can see, well, the student that scored level 2 had three times more likely to graduate in 4 years than those that score level 1. Level 3 students are 15 times more likely. And level 4 are 55 times more likely. So when I say that you won't improve the graduation rate, I mean you could improve it in a short term by putting all the resources in just at the top end, like some districts have done. Or you can look at your data and say, what happened to a child when that child entered the Rochester City School District? And how do you track progress year by year? And please go to the next slide. As you can see here, a child who entered high school, ninth grade at level one, the graduation rate for that group is 13%. For the child that has scored level two, the graduation rate is 19% for the four-year completion. For the child that enters at level three, 76% chance. Level four, 94%. And here is the sad reality. Basically, our latest score, over 70% of our students are at level one. So my hope is that this year we see some progress. I know people have been working very, very, very hard. And because I've been saying, unless you improve the elementary, reading skill in particular, and that's why our third grade reading level is so important. And I will remind us that early childhood education is not pre-K. There's no one that we argue with me that is not. And that's why you need an integrated approach and you need a sense of urgency and discipline to do this work. Unless we continue to see, we will continue to see our graduation rate to be one of the lowest in the state of New York, as we have today. We had the worst at the elementary level. It's no surprise that we had the worst graduation rate in the state of New York. And there's a sense of urgency, and I know the board and this community and the school community and teachers and principal are working very hard. But unless we drastically improve the reading level of our students at the elementary level, our graduation rate will continue to suffer. Also, our achievement rate in terms of getting kids ready for college and career also will suffer. If you go to the next slide, you can see that a child who is at level four attend college at 98%, level one, 6%. Level two, 25%, and level three, 53%. Now, we don't have the data because we're on tracker for 6 years to see the success of our students in terms of college completion, because it's not just going to college, it's also completing college. So, once again, one may have whatever opinion one want to have about the state assessment, but one undeniable fact is that there's a strong correlation between your level one, level two and three and four, and your chance to graduating from high school and your chance to participate in college. Again, this raised some question, and the question that we are researching is, so the 13% of the kids that were level one, where were the contributing factor that allowed them, even though they can, with low level skill, at least 13% were able to make it? So can we do more? And those are short-term questions. The long-term answer is to improve from pre-K, because that's when we have control here, all the way to 12th grade, year by year. And this work had to be relentless. It had to include all of us. Uh, 12% of the eighth grader at level three and level four drop out of high school. Again, we can learn. What is it that even though you had the skill set necessary to succeed in school, you still left school? And that's an individual group question for our students. What the number told us is that the students who achieve early, in the early years, and the research elsewhere validate this, that if a child is not reading a grade level by third grade, the likelihood that that child will graduate diminishes significantly. Actually, 13 times less by some research. State assessment matter, and it's unfortunate that sometimes the politics gets in the way. Because some of us say, well, it doesn't matter. Well, tell that child that couldn't finish high school because of the assessment, or because we didn't take it as serious as we need to take it. Teacher, principal, and central office administrator, we are targeting our assessment, and actually this year, I was very happy in terms of what I saw and what I've been seeing in our school. There's a sense of focus, new energy. I just got an email that I will conclude where one principal sent me this email and she said, I just began to research the expectation for children in Brighton, Gate, Honey Oil Fall, and the expectation, and one of our speakers mentioned sight words that children ought to be, ought to know when they get to in kindergarten. And I was pleased to hear that, and that you as a mom are reinforcing that at home. Needless to say, they raised the expectation to 100 words, although in most districts they expect the children to learn about 40 sight words, and some even 25. That was the case in the Rochester City School District. They raised it to 100. You should see the chart. In that particular school, as has been reported to me by the principal, children are learning up to 200 words in some area. And she concluded, I say, expectation matter. And we need to have high expectation at the superintendent's office, at the school level, at the community level. All of us, our children are as smart, capable, as any group of children in Monroe County, in this state, in this nation. And I do believe that if we give our children and our teachers the time and support, that we will succeed. But it had to be with discipline and accountability and relentless, relentless effort in the part of all of us.
I have a question.
Any comments or questions?
My question is, this is the first time that I've seen this level system of 1 through 4. And since this is being offered up as a, you know, using data to improve student achievement, it would be excellent to have a definition of these levels and to have the algorithm and formula that are used and the source of those. But beyond that, I really want to challenge back in terms of the charge of, you know, the implication of relatively low expectations compared to high expectations from those of us who are seeking the protective effect of more inquiry-based and more developmentally appropriate education, whether it's through a Montessori model, whether it's through expeditionary learning, integrated approaches in School 15, those kinds of approaches that are protective against the extremely standardized, you know, what is being framed as highly rigorous and high expectations. I personally take offense to the idea that I have low expectations because I take a position that is actually evidence-based, research-informed, that challenges the high-stakes context of testing, standardized testing used in the way that it's being used. Your comments are urging us to have even higher stakes value toward the testing. This algorithm, I'm assuming, is meant to reinforce the importance of high stakes testing. I will not have my children take the standardized tests when they start third grade and on up. They will not take them because they are harmful and they are not accurate and they are not appropriate. And they will not be harmed by that effect. So I just want to directly say, I don't buy it. I have as high expectations. I come from a family of PhD chemists, of people who are committed to public service, of people who are very thoughtful and value high expectations and education. And those of us who push back and who value the protective benefits of project-based learning, inquiry-based learning, we have very high expectations. And we see the interplay between things like sight word lists, which my kids work with, and inquiry-based learning. So I felt the need to articulate that.
Mr. Powell?
Yes, thank you. I will agree that with the part of your presentation that says that children need to be learning by third grade. That's an expectation that it is awfully hard to argue with. It wouldn't be wise of someone in my position to argue against it. But I would turn your attention to the Children's Institute report. It's on the internet under childrensinstitute.net. And if you go to, you can do an internal search on the Rochester City School District and find the annual report on our pre-K. And there's a graph that indicates how much learning takes place naturally in the course of a preschooler's 10 months in school, and then how much learning takes place essentially that's attributable to being in UPK. And it essentially suggests that two additional years worth of learning takes place because a child goes to UPK. But there's another graph a little bit later in the report that demonstrates the summer learning loss is about 30%. So it occurs to me that when we talk about having a child read by third grade, I assume we mean the end of third grade, and knowing how valuable UPK is, but how much is lost in the summertime, I have to wonder if we're still doing it wrong. It's not UPK we're doing wrong, but do you know that we don't do summer school until fourth and fifth and sixth grade? What if we started summer school pre-K, after kindergarten, after first grade, while these children are still developing, so that there is no break in their learning, so there is no summer learning loss, and they most certainly have a better chance of learning to read by third grade. I am so thrilled with this visual device. You cannot unring a bell. Once a child has learned to read, you cannot take that away from them. So the challenge is for us to get kids, you know, through the summer without summer learning loss, through kindergarten, first grade, so that the stage is set so they can successfully read by third grade. I don't think that our methodology in how we get there is nearly as important as the time commitment we make to getting there. Your initiative on truancy and getting and targeting the kindergarten first grade parents who clearly aren't as committed to having their children in school as a first grader should be. You know, to have 40 absences by January. I mean, targeting that and knowing you've got to get them in their seats and then you got to keep them in their seats. But like I said, once a child is reading, if we can devote all our resources, including summer school, not starting at fourth and fifth grade, but starting at first and second, or kindergarten and first, I think that's what we have to be seriously thinking. Not how we are going to rearrange central office and the bureaucracy and the flow charts and the org charts, but how we're actually going to deliver the services to the kids.
You are music to my ears, so this would be a historic effort because your budget, for the first time, includes summer learning for every K through third grade for enrichment and also for kid that I behind. And you absolutely correct, Commissioner Power, that the summer learning loss is a serious one, particular for children coming from poverty background. And you are right My fear is the sustainability. If you see your budgets, a significant amount of dollars is going to that effort. And you, one of the work that my administration is trying to do is to eliminate the structural budget gap for the arts, for the music, for the sport, for the extracurricular activity, for services, for support, and yes, for achievement. Our students need to be learning year-round, and particularly given that our children are the most vulnerable, and the summer learning loss. It's a historic budget, but my greater fear is sustainability. And the only way that you can sustain the type of budget that I'm putting forward for you, and more to come, because we need to do more in so many areas about closing the opportunity gap, in, you know, providing summer learning opportunity for children K-3 is no small number, and we even need to invest more. But you cannot invest in everything. And I'm afraid that this district haven't yet learned that lesson, that you cannot do it all. You can do a few things well, and this district is in desperate need to do a few things well, just like we do pre-K well. We also need to do summer learning well. We need to make sure that we do kindergarten well, and that we, it's an integrated system that we need to have here. But again, thank you, because you, for the first time, you're gonna vote, I might hope, in your budget that you find that important. That's a great, great observation. But my fear is that we, as a board, will not have the discipline to pay attention to the sad reality that resources is are not endless, and the resources that we have to focus very clearly. I've been challenging, for example, about the art. I know I'm not supporting enough the art, but it's better than what we had when I came here, or music, or all the sport, or support for kids, or more time on learning, more time on task. But those things cost money, and it's a significant investment. And I'm so glad that you mentioned the summer learning loss, because I feel so passionate when I see so many children in our community during the summer. And if the school board doesn't step to the plate to provide that summer learning gap or to close that summer learning gap, who will?
I just want to add some very, very brief remarks. Dr. Vargas, kudos to your team on 2 points. This is at least the second meeting in a row on Thursday, which you guys have begun your report with data, giving us, that is the community, a sense as to where we're at and when we expect to get to where we need to get to. And this is the second meeting which this data has been presented in a different way. So it's not always presented the same way. So we do appreciate that. Is this stuff available on our website?
It's on board docs.
It's on board docs. Mary Adams is looking at me, and I know she's making a comment, but this is my turn to talk, right? and then my only other observation, you know, not for debate, this is just my view. I want to give kudos to your team on this work plan that the board asked you to put together. It's called, you guys don't have, it's called Superintendent's Report Due to Board Regarding the Implementation of Existing Board Policies. The background to this is, this board said to the superintendent about 2 months ago, you got about 24, 25 policies on the books that have been in the books for the last 2-3 decades, and not a single one of them has been delivered upon by any superintendent. And these were good policies, not even necessarily passed by this board. And we asked the superintendent to bring the administration up to date. And they have a work plan. I don't know if this is available on the website, but it should be. And it tells us how he expects to get this administration in line and in sync with the policies of this board. One of the things I say is I have a to-do list. First thing we have to do is we have to do what we say we're going to do. This is very simple. Success is very simple. We have to do what we say we're going to do. Second thing is we have to do what we're obligated to do under the law. We don't do that often in this district. And finally, we must do or replicate what we do well. Very simple. I know the Common Core and No Child Left Behind and Race to the Top has us thinking in 20 different directions, but it's really quite simple. And I want to thank Dr. Vargas and his team for allowing us to see that we're about doing what we're supposed to do. And this chart has his team with individuals who are responsible for reporting. I think it's to Mr. Lopez. Is that your responsibility? And each team member that's responsible for in a due date. This is awesome stuff, so I want to thank you for doing that. Any other comments on the superintendent's report?
The only thing I'll say is I just think that as a district and as a community, we know what the challenges are, and I think that we just need to stay focused on fixing them. So, I mean, we know the graduation rate is low. We know that our kids are lagging behind, but I think that we need to really, really make sure that we stay focused on solutions for fixing those things. And then, more importantly, we have to make sure, too, that we evaluate internally and externally in real time whether or not things are working. And then if they're not, we need to make sure we recalibrate and fix them. And I think that that's where we fall down. And if we don't do that, we'll be sitting here, well, hopefully I won't be sitting here, 20 years from now, talking about the same stuff.
Your son will be sitting here.
Not if he's smart. 20 years from now, rehashing the same things over and over again. I think that that's the challenge. And how you bring about hope, I think, is to, you know, making sure that we put forth, here's the problem, but here's the solution, here's what we're going to do about it. Summer learning is one opportunity, I think, that I'm happy to hear about, but there are others. But also, when stuff isn't working, we just need to admit that it's not working and then move on to something else. So I think we need to keep that in mind as we go forward.
That's right. Mary, I didn't mean to be rude, but did you want to say something in response
to that? No, I was being rude. I was just saying you were appreciating the data, but it's undefined. That was just...
Fair enough.
So until it's defined, we can't really, in my opinion, appreciate it.
Fair enough. All right, we're now moving on to board reports. We try to keep the folks here as long as we can, but there are some folks that have to get home. And we're going to first start with our student report and then Makita, who is our parent rep. She's sighing over there, but we got to get the student first. Okay, all right. And we're going to get Makita next, her and her folks. I see Makita here probably 3 times a week, bless her heart. So we do appreciate you staying just a few minutes longer. Student report, Sophie.
Yes, good evening. So one of my big things that I want to report on is students have been working on our student talent showcase, which is Wednesday, April 30th. At Wilson High School from 6 to 8 p.m. There are flyers and posters around the building, and it's going to be up on the district website, and we're going to do a robocall home too. But it's a fundraiser for students in Student Leadership Congress to raise funds for their trip to Washington, D.C., where we get to meet our representatives and students from around the nation and grow our young civic leadership skills. It's an amazing trip, and students put this entire night together. So they went to local businesses and solicited donations. They got a $250 gift certificate from Wegmans to use to decorate for the event, as well as get refreshments for the event. They've organized all the student talent and held auditions. They also helped pair up with the Rochester Police Department, because police officers will be performing too. So it shall be a really great night that hopefully brings the community together. We are asking for a $5 to $10 donation, if you can, at the door, because it is for students to have this amazing experience. The event is April 30th, so please come. That's it for my report. Thank you.
That's a talent show?
Oh, well, it's a student showcase, but there's also going to be different items that we'll be auctioning off, such as student artwork, as well as in the back, there's a basket of antique books with a bunch of different cultures and art history, and that different baskets like that we'll be auctioning off. So if you're interested in supporting students, please come.
I got some great books back there. Really old books that would be worthy of anybody's collection. I saw a couple of them back during commissioners and in conversation. I was asking about the talent show because I was wondering maybe Malik and I could do like a Blues Brothers.
Oh, yeah. We would love that.
Why are you laughing, Beverly? Why are you laughing? Just a cough? All right. Makita, thank you very much. Let's give Makita a round of applause. She works really hard. Chair, is it the chair or is it the president of PAC?
I'm the chair.
The chair of PAC.
And I wasn't sighing, but I thank you for letting me go earlier. I appreciate that. And for those that don't know, I am the chair of the Parent Advisory Council. And the Parent Advisory Council consists of 12 parents. I serve as the chair, and Victoria Robertson serves as the vice chair. Just wanted to discuss a couple of things with you guys tonight, and so good evening for, you know. Some of the parents' concerns that we have is that we're disappointed that the superintendent's budget does not address the recommendations of the four ad hoc committees convened by President White. This was a great example of community members, parents, guardians, and students working together to offer solutions to some of the district's problems. This accomplishment should not have been ignored, and the participants should not feel that their hard work was in vain, a political move, or a publicity stunt. We are aware that all of the recommendations cannot be implemented. However, PAC believes the following should be strongly considered for implementation. From the Student Achievement Committee, the Create a Youth Council on Instructional Improvement is one recommendation. Another from the Student and Community Safety would be the recommendation to adopt a holistic and therapeutic approach towards students with behavior difficulties, focusing on addressing underlying needs and difficulties, and establishing a clear structure to foster trust. From the Student Achievement Committee, also establish an Office of Social Justice. And the Student and Community Safety Committee, alternatives to suspension should be restored, as in many schools as fiscally feasible, beginning with schools that have the highest student suspension rates. For the Parent Engagement Committee, there were about four that we thought should be implemented. We are the Parent Advisory Council, so. One would be to elevate and strengthen OPE, the Office of Parent Engagement, by adding staff and having it report directly to a cabinet level position. There's too many levels between the superintendent and Office of Parent Engagement, which then down to us, the parents. Also having the parent liaisons, home school assistants, report directly to OPE to focus on parent engagement to strengthen that. Also redefine the roles and the job descriptions of the parent liaisons and home school assistants. Ensure that all family engagement policies are strictly enforced, and develop a parent bill of rights, which the Parent Advisory Council is working on. We do have an ad hoc committee to help develop that, which we will then also turn that to the community and other parents to also help us with establishing the parent bill of rights. Other concerns? Violence continues to be a concern of parents. This week we had another shooting and murder across the street from one of our schools. While we know that the district is unable to control what occurs outside of our schools, it is imperative that parents are notified of occurrences near our schools. Parents should not have to hear of incidents on the news or through their children. The district has to do a better job of advising parents as soon as possible. It's unacceptable to not distribute a robocall or wait until 4 hours after the incident occurs. PAC has met with the Communications Department and Safety and Security to advise that this practice is unacceptable. We recommend that parents are notified of the information as soon as possible, even if the information is limited. We also advise to make a follow-up robocall when more information is available. This tragic event was an opportunity to demonstrate that they have learned from previous mistakes and took our input seriously. Also, many parents are upset over the school placement process. A lot of concerns were regarding acceptance to SOTA, Wilson Foundation, and World of Inquiry. Parents are confused about the process, especially if their child auditioned for SOTA but received letters placing them at their second or third choice. Parents have been frustrated when calling the placement office because they are given different answers by depending on who answers the phone. There needs to be consistent process. However, this is more evidence that SOTA should not have a separate process. This is an excellent opportunity for the district to reevaluate its placement policy. And finally, parents are still very concerned about the fate of East and the fate of other schools in the district as well. These are just some of the concerns that we're highlighting. Some of our recent activity, PAC has been extremely busy because there's been a lot of things going on in the district, as we all know. So busy, sometimes we don't get to have our own business meetings because we're addressing so many of the things that's going on in the district. But we have had the opportunity to meet with some of the board members Monday night for our quarterly meeting. So thank you, President White, Commissioner Adams, and Commissioner Campos for attending. At our meeting, we discussed the options for East as well as the ad hoc committee's suggestions. Also in the past month, PAC members have attended the advanced placement meeting to discuss school discipline reform and the Connect Ed meeting regarding linked learning pathways to college and career. Barb Van Kerhove, I don't know how to pronounce her last name, I'm sorry, but she's the parent representative to the policy committee and also a PAC member. She has made a proposal to change the values education policy. Her proposal includes renaming the policy to civic education policy to expand and revise to incorporate civic learning more generally in addition to the democratic values and principles. And PAC strongly accepts her proposal. For the parent group report, every month we like to report on where we are as far as parent groups and school-based planning teams and having the correct number of parents on those school-based planning and having a functioning parent group. Unfortunately, here we are 6 months into the deadline, 2 months away from the end of the school year, and we still have three schools that do not have a functional parent group. That's School 28, Robert Brown, and STEM. That's extremely disappointing. We're at the end of the school year and they do not have a functioning parent group. But we're saying that we're 100% compliance and school-based planning teams. However, we are still receiving complaints that the required number of parents are still not a part of some teams. As previously mentioned, OPE is responsible for obtaining the information, and they report it out to us. But it is important that the schools stay compliant. It's their responsibility to make sure that they have a functional parent group as well as the correct number of parents on their school-based planning teams. I also want to invite everyone to or let them know about some of the events. Well, we'll definitely invite you to the Title I Parent Conference, which is the RCSD Family Affair in the Park at Charlotte Beach on May 17th. It will be from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. So please come out. Well, last year was very successful, and I would like it to be even more successful this year. Hopefully we'll have some good weather. We are in Rochester, though. The annual school-based planning team, the Executive School-Based Planning Committee hosts the annual school-based planning team training. It was scheduled to be held in April. However, it was postponed to support the community forum at East High School. We are looking to do this event on June 13th, but due to some pending upcoming meetings in May, that could conflict with having such an important meeting that can potentially impact the turnout for this event. Also, there's a Latino Parents Conference on June 14th that we also hope that you attend. Thank you very much. I appreciate it, and thank you for the applause in the beginning. I do the work that I do for our children, and not just my children, but all the children and the parents and guardians in the school district. Thank you.
Thank you, McKee. We really appreciate it. Okay, standing committee reports. Commissioner Powell.
Yes, thank you. The Finance Committee met as usual the week before their board meeting, which was Thursday, April 17th. We considered resolutions 603 through 619 and 625 and 626. This month, the resolutions include budget amendments for 2013-14. And the first two resolutions are budget amendment resolutions. Tied to that are the March 2014 financial reports. The committee did recommend approval of those, and at this time I move that the March 2014 financial reports be received by the board.
Second.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. That was the only report that needs to come before the board. We did discuss one procurement and supply, which was Resolution 607, and recommends for approval. Under the facilities, we had Resolutions 608 through 619. Some of these are new contracts, and others are final payments. And in the last of that batch, the 619, is our FPFI, which is our report to the state, which helps us get our building aid. And then 625 is a IM&T resolution, technology resolution, and 626 is categorized under other. It is a lease proposal that the Martin Street location, that we lease the third floor, or sublease rather, the third floor to grow out charter school. This would allow us to recover some of our lease costs for the use of that building, which we initially entered into a lease agreement for, so that we would have swing space for the FMP. But since we're almost through phase one and haven't started phase two, we're in a place where we have surplus square footage capacity and no students that we need to move into that space. I believe that concludes my report. All of the resolutions were recommended for advancement. And our next Finance Committee meeting will be Thursday, May 15th, and it will be following the Board Governance and the Policy Committee meeting. So if I take my best guess, it'll be sometime after 7 o'clock.
Thank you. Commissioner Evans?
Yes, the Excellence Student Achievement Committee deferred their meeting in our meeting in April for the East High School public hearing, which took place. I do want to mention, yesterday I had the opportunity to attend the HEART Coalition for Drug-Free Rochester, City of Rochester SOAR Program, Safe Sex, Inc. Youth Leaders, and the Metro Council of Teen Potential, hosted the district to discuss one of our favorite topics, food service. And I just want to let the superintendent know that Mike Schmidt, David Brown, Deli from Aramark, and also the dietitian that were there were excellent with the students. The students that were there did a great job, and I think that a lot of those students, Mr. President, will be great candidates for the instructional design committee. I'm always impressed with the level in which our students conduct themselves in their knowledge of the district, but the food service staff in this district did a great job in engaging the students in meaningful dialogue. And if you talk to any of them that were there, they'll tell you these kids were just sharp. And what I respect about the staff that was there is they gave it to them straight, told them how things were, but also handed out information and stated that they would follow up on any of the students' concerns. So very, very constructive meeting, and I was happy to be a part of it. The next ESA committee meeting, we'll be scheduling it in May, and we will get that date out. Usually it follows the Community and Intergovernmental Relations Committee. But in the event that CIGR does not meet in May, we'll meet a little earlier. So stay tuned on the date for that. And that concludes my report, Mr. President.
Mr. Cruz.
Thank you, Mr. President. On Thursday, April 17th, our Policy Committee met. We went over several resolutions, including parent and family engagement, revision to the parent school-based policy, planning policy, and visitors to school policy, student records and privacy, and suspected child abuse policy. For your consideration tonight, you will have number 623, which is the proposed revision to the school-based planning policy. With regard to parent and family engagement, we reviewed that. We've still got some more tweaking to do. We'll get that done, and my hope is that we'll have it to the board, the full board, at our next meeting. With regard to student records and privacy, there was some minor revisions to the policy. We're, I think we're just adding some information there. I think Mr. Lopez. Suspected child abuse policy, we are looking at restructuring that into two sections, one for abuse and maltreatment, the other one for education, for abuse in an education setting. We've got new material in there. There's, the policy also contains state ed law, because this all closely has to follow state law, obviously. So we discussed that as well. So you've got a number of these for discussion and information items over the next couple months. Our next meeting, I should say that I want to thank the staff, Mr. Lopez and your staff, for putting together the calendar, because I know it was out of a discussion of the board, but it was the policy committee that followed up on it to make sure that it got done. And so I want to thank the policy committee for following up on that as well. I think we now have, as Mr. President, you said, there are dates. There are, more importantly, people who are responsible for those reports. So I think we'll get them. And we added an additional step as a way of monitoring this. We are asking Mr. Lopez and his staff to present to the policy committee at its meeting before the board meeting, where these reports are due, a quick summary of those reports so that the policy committee knows what's going to the board, so we can also, as a way of monitoring that, keep abreast of what's going on with some of these policies. And if there's any issues, we can sort of grab those early on. Our next meeting is May 15th on a Thursday. Thank you very much.
Yep, sure. Commissioner Adams?
The audit committee was not scheduled to meet in the month of April and did not meet in the month of April. The next audit committee meeting is scheduled for Tuesday, May 6th at 5:30 p.m. At that meeting, we'll be meeting with Fried Maxick, the external auditor, to review the audit plan for the June 30th, 2014 independent audit. All board members are encouraged to attend. That's May 6th at 5:30. That concludes my audit report. I'd also like to mention the Ad Hoc Common Core Committee that I chair met last evening, and we had an excellent presentation from Dr. Richard Ryan, who is a psychology professor at the University of Rochester, and he reviewed his self-determination theory, which he and some other researchers have developed over the decades, and it was a very, very interesting and relevant discussion regarding motivation, intrinsic motivation versus extrinsic, and the impacts that has on lifelong learning, love of learning, and it was really relevant to some of these discussions and debates, you know, regarding the direction of how we improve learning, how we get to those high test scores. You know, is it through high stakes pressure, or is it through, you know, developing the sense of autonomy among children? So the tape will be posted. I would encourage people to listen to it.
Thank you. Yes.
On the board docs?
We try to post the audio from those meetings on board docs.
As a WAV file?
As what?
As a WAV file? WAV?
I don't know whether it's an MP3 or a WAV. But it's an audio file that you can click on.
Great, thank you.
I'll try to be very brief. I have to provide two reports. One is for Commissioner Elliott. And she had reported that she went to the National School Board Conference in New Orleans. She was there with none other than Commissioner Evans and myself. And actually, we had a brief moment to spend some time together at, what was the name of the restaurant? I was amazed at Malik's plate. He had this huge plate of food. But I forgot the name of the restaurant. But it was good because we had an opportunity to, you wouldn't think, you think, oh, they're just going to have a good time. The whole time we were there, this is the guys on the truth, we just talked about school board stuff. No time for, we did laugh a little bit.
Yeah,
it was just about school board stuff. So it was a good conference, and Commissioner Elliott has that in her report. That was the reason why she didn't have a CIGR meeting that month, and I think because it conflicted with the travel dates of the National School Board Association, where, of course, Magic Johnson began his public relations campaign, which basically says, I believe in public schools. He gave a dynamic, no script, no teleprompter. He walked around the crowd and just talked about the importance of public education. He talked about charters versus, you know, traditional public schools. It was a really dynamic, powerful conversation. And I just got a message from the chair of the National School Board, the executive director, saying that that campaign is now going to be featured in Newsweek magazine. So you're going to start seeing people defend the quality of education that they can receive in traditional public schools. She reported that they continue to work, I think at the suggestion of the board, on trying to create a timeline that for budget discussions that coincides with what our legislators do in Albany and Washington. I think there was some discussion, and I think I'm sure Cynthia was listening, that oftentimes when we get ready to talk about our budget, the legislators have already passed their budget. So she notes that they're trying to figure out how they can reconcile those calendars and make sure we're having conversations to the legislators in Albany and the governor's office that so that we get what we need come budget time. And it's not a conversation after they've already passed their budget. She notes that their next meeting is June the 10th at 6 p.m. My president's report, I want to pick up on this National Association of School Boards conference. I want to thank the Board of Education here in Rochester and the entire team, particularly those who are here and those who are not. Joanne, remember Joanne, who was secretary for many years? Were it not for Joanne and Jackie and Shanae, and of course this board supporting the work that we do when we go on these trips, these conferences, I would not be honored to tell you that at that meeting for the National School Boards Association, I was elected chair of the Council of Urban Boards of Education. It's a real honor and a real blessing, and as a result of that, thank you. As a result of that honor, I now sit on the board of directors for the National Association of School Boards. So it was a real honor, and I hope that I will serve you well and represent you well. And I hope that as a result of that, we can get some recognition for all the good work that everybody here is doing in Rochester, New York. Additionally, I should note, and this is very important because we cannot say thanks enough, because in this work you need to hold up people that try to hold you up. And you all may not have noticed this, but we get this beautiful artwork. Have you noticed we got these wonderful little ceramic things? And did you ever wonder where all that stuff is coming from? Well, I did. And thanks to Nissa, Henry Wheeler, and Shanae, who did some little investigative work, and they found out that it's a bunch of teachers in schools that have been leaving this stuff for us, like little Santa gifts for us. Maureen Frazier, and I apologize for taking time to do this, but it is important. Maureen Frazier at number 29 school, those quilled snowflakes that we had. These things are like all in our offices now, and some are in our homes. Jen Woods at number 39 school, the African mass pin, I remember that. Penny Carlson Palma, who I think spoke earlier today. Number 45, the ceramic flower cups. I actually have room deodorizer sitting in that little ceramic cup in my office. It's a beautiful little cup. Nancy Navinska at number 20, ceramic flower pots with real flowers in them. Helen Rayner at number 42 school, 4th of July flag pins. And Colleen Meltz, number 28 school, embossed tin eyes. Those are really nice. We thank you for providing those very gracious and important gifts, and they remind us of the children that we are working for. I should note very briefly, you all know we're working very diligently and very hard on East High School and trying to address those issues that are presented. It's a truncated time frame. It's a challenge for all of us. I should tell you, as we've said repeatedly, a number of things are happening at one time. There are a lot of balls in the air, but we're very focused on what's happening. Dr. Vargas is working diligently on coming up with, I call it this, a plan B, an alternative plan that he will present to the Board of Education on May the 5th. The deadline, of course, is May the 16th. Is it May the 5th, 15th, Ed?
15th,
thank you. That's the two-week extension that we got from the state. Additionally, as you all know, you probably heard, we met with a bunch of folks from central office, and we did something unique and different. We included teachers, we included administrators, we included students and staff, and I gotta tell you, if I look back on this year, in December 31st, 2014, I think one of the proudest moments I think this board will have is we did something so unique, so different, and very powerful. The questions that those folks asked, what was it, a total of 40, Five questions, 40.
49.
49 questions. Everybody was there. There were some great probative questions. You're gonna serve this community. We're going to make sure that you are properly vetted. And there was not a single question on there that I don't think. And, you know, Beverly was there. She asked great questions. But in addition to Beverly's questions, there were a lot of other good questions put by people who are not in central office. I was very proud of what our citizens came up with. School turnaround is going to have to work real hard to get us the answers to those very legitimate questions, and I'm very proud of what our citizens and, of course, our board members were there also asking very probing questions. On my report, which I think would be available on the website, our report's on the website, they're not?
Board docs.
But not everybody can get to the board docs. Well, maybe we should talk about that. But a number of people participated, and they know who they are, and we are really appreciative. We will have follow-up meetings with those individuals. I've already described for you what the time frame is. I also want to tell you all that as we sort of manage the different objects in the air, as we try to figure out what is best for East High School, I should tell you that this board is committed to examining every possibility. So there are possibilities that you don't see that we see. And I just want to let this community know that you have a Board of Education that is examining every possible alternative that will produce the best results for East High School and perhaps produce a model for this district in addressing future challenges such that East High School has. And I also want to point out to you all, we've learned, we all learn from the things that we do and the things that we don't do. And one of the things we've said, and without exception, every board member has supported this notion, that we have to have a pipeline report. We have to know what is coming down the pike that is similar to what East High School experienced. I will tell you all, we will get some more letters next year, maybe one, maybe two, telling us we have to make some decisions. But what will not happen next year is we will not be facing the barrel of a gun. We will not be looking at a truncated time frame of 6 weeks. You know why? Because Dr. Vargas will provide us a pipeline report that will tell us now what we will be looking at next year. So we will have the time that we did not have this year to plan for a meaningful set of programs that will produce measurable results. The budget discussions continue. The only thing I would add, and I'll leave the rest of this part of my report out, is I truly appreciate the cooperation. I don't know if Bill's, oh, there he is, he got his head down. Bill Ansborough and his entire team, I know they are working very hard. And that's what makes this whole thing very challenging. We're trying to talk about East High School. We're trying to talk about the budget. We're trying to make sure that our priorities are straight. And Commissioner Powell, we cannot thank you enough for every year, for I don't know how many years. Malik, she was answered your call. She's answered this board's call once again to manage this very difficult process. And she even said to me, it's not only the stuff that she reads, but she calls me up yesterday or the day before yesterday and say, hey, can you make it to this meeting with Bill? And I couldn't make it, but I called him by phone, and she and Bill were very gracious, and we had our meeting in part by phone and part in person. So I want to thank Dr. Vargas for having Bill available. And it's a very difficult and challenging effort. But we're going to manage it, and we're going to manage it well. The Youth Council on Instructional Improvement, that is Resolution 629. Makita mentioned the special committee recommendations. That is also an ongoing part of our budget conversations. I am hopeful, as I have been prayerful, that this board will pass Resolution 629. It creates a council that could indeed change the way we create curriculum, even with the constraints of Common Core, No Child Left Behind, and Race to the Top. I think there are opportunities to input from our students engaging, exciting curriculum ideas that will keep our students in our seats. So that is Resolution 629, and I hope that gets your favorable review. As Sophie said, there's a talent showcase on April 30th at Wilson Magnet High School. Our next leadership meeting, which we'll have none other than Commissioner Evans, it will take place at Wilson Commencement Academy at 7:30 on April the 30th. And that's an appropriate place to meet, given the conversations that we had today. For you all that don't know, at those leadership meetings, they happen every week. We switch them to Wednesday. And the first thing that Ed and Beverly and Bohan will tell you that we talk about is Where's the finish line? We have, at these meetings, the first thing we talk about is where are we at and where are we going and how are we going to get there? With each school, we have these meetings at the place. So if there's gunfire, if there's concern about gunfire, if there's concern about where the school is going, we'll be there talking about it on April the 30th. That ends my report. So we
Mr. President?
Yes, sir.
You know I'm not one to belabor a meeting.
Yeah, I know that.
You know,
I'm surprised you're...
The president was being modest. He kind of just mentioned he got elected to CUBE and said, you know, thanks for work. But I think a lot of people should know that this that someone from Rochester chairing the council, and you may not know what CUBE stands for, the Council of Urban Boards of Education. I won't use the words that Joe Biden used when Obama signed the health care law, but it is a big deal. To be chosen as chair of the Council of Urban Boards of Education. Rochester is really a medium-sized district when you look at the overall CUBE. I mean, it's every just about every large district in the country is represented by this body. And so, I mean, we're talking, they look at policies, they meet with national leaders to craft policy, they put on probably one of the best conferences that I've ever been a part of. So it really is a big deal to have someone from Rochester and to have the President Van White there. So I think we should give him another round of applause for that. It's a big deal, and I'm honored that you're going to be representing us there. He kind of glossed over it, but it's a big deal to have that representation. I just thought I'd say that.
Thank you.
I'm just going to heap more praise on top of praise and remind our audience that President Van White also serves on the New York State School Board Association Diversity Committee with me, and we're going to be starting a very interesting endeavor. We're going to consider the possibility of establishing standards, not unlike standards that are set up for students and teachers and administrators, but standards for board members as a means of essentially responding to the state's argument that the reason schools fail is because boards of education fail. So we need to get out ahead of that argument and say, these are what boards are supposed to do by law and otherwise, and when boards are doing this and this and this, they are meeting their obligation, and therefore, when schools fail, it's not necessarily because their board failed. So we're at the discussion stage, but the motivation behind that is to get out ahead of the charge that school boards are unilateral or uniformly deficient and get ahead of an effort to essentially de-democratize the governance of education.
Thank you. All right, so let's move on to the consideration of resolutions. Could I get a motion to discuss resolutions 573 to 594?
So moved.
Yes, ma'am.
Could we separate resolution 581 and talk about it in executive session?
We can do that. So what we're going to talk about, if there's an appropriate motion, we're going to talk about resolutions 573 through 594 with the exception of 581. Well, actually, is there a motion to separate? Do we need a motion to do that? Not really. No, not for a discussion. Yeah, so we're just going to talk about resolutions 573 to 594. We're not going to talk about resolution 581. Can I get a motion to discuss those?
I'll make that motion.
All right. And it's seconded, I assume. Commissioner Cruz, Mary. Any discussion? There being no discussion, can I get all those in favor of resolutions 573 through 594 minus resolutions 581? Say aye.
Aye.
Any noes? Madam Clerk, you recorded that vote. Yes, you did. Can I get a motion to discuss resolutions? All right, is there a second?
Second.
Well, of course, we're talking about 595 to 602. That motion to discuss having been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion on resolutions 592 to 602? I have to say I'm abstaining from resolution 602 when we take that vote, but any other discussion? There being no discussion, can I get a vote? And all those in favor of resolutions 595 through 602, say aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstains? There's one, Madam Clerk, that's me on 602. Can I get a motion
Mr. Cruz, I'm just waiting for you to just say.
Oh.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Well, of course, we're talking about, we want to discuss Resolution 603 to 606. There being a motion and a second, let's talk about 603 to 606. Any comment?
These went through finance, Mr. President, so I would call the question.
All right. All those in favor of Resolution 603 to 606, say aye.
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 Any noes? The ayes have it. Got that, Madam Clerk? Are y'all keeping pace out there? 607. 607. Can I get a motion to discuss? All right. And there's a second?
Second, Mr. President.
All right. Now, any discussion on Resolution 607, procurement and supply? No. There being no discussion, all those in favor of Resolution 607, say aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Madam Clerk, the ayes have it on Resolution 607. 608 through 619, motion to discuss.
Move it, Mr. President.
There's a second. All right. There any, being any discussion regarding 608 to 619?
I have a quick request.
Oh, no, no, it doesn't have to be quick.
Well, to keep it moving here.
No, no, no.
We're going to
keep it moving.
What'd you say? She got it right.
Regarding 611, if we could have an update on the long-term plans or short and long-term plans for the school that Wells Foundation building sometime over the next couple of weeks, that would be great.
That was 6?
619.
611.
611.
It talked about cancellation of some previously planned,
okay.
And we know that students are not there currently, but I've been curious as to what the plan for that building is.
Thank you.
So Dr. Vargas, he's got that. For folks who want to know, we're given these packets, and some of us really use technology, board docs. I like the hard copies, but we're given these packets a week in advance, so because we're moving at breakneck speed, I don't want you to think that we're not looking at this stuff. We haven't examined it. We have. We're just moving it along because we have done the proper vetting in advance. And many of these, in the case of the finance ones, they've been vetted through the committee process. And you've heard Commissioner Cruz talk at length about different policies. So, again, I want, for those that are watching, to understand that just because we're moving quickly doesn't mean that these particular resolutions haven't been thoroughly vetted and considered. All right, so can I get a motion on resolutions, 608 to 619?
You got a motion. I'm ready to call the question, Mr.
Oh, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
620 through 634, a motion to discuss those resolutions.
So moved, Mr. President.
Any discussion? I would only add that I won't elaborate. Oh, I'm sorry. Is it a second?
Second.
All right. Now, with respect to 629, I would only add that to my comments earlier that to put in its proper context, this Youth Council on Instructional Improvement was an idea that came out of the special committees. It was, in fact, our own Sophie's idea and a powerful idea. And I think, among other things that will come out of this if the board approves it, is a new way of doing business. I think the evidence is very clear. The best leadership comes from listening. And I think Commissioner Evans said it earlier when in the context of talking about food service. Our young folks, they are just filled with ideas. And Dr. Vargas is spending a lot of time getting folks back to their seats. And we saw an example of a school, the Young Men's Academy, is doing that. When they get back to their seats, when he gets them back into their seats, and that's the goal, and that's what he's doing, it is critical, it is essential that these young people have something that is interesting, that is engaging. And I think if we listen to these young people, they may have a lesson or two to teach us about what might keep kids in their seats. So I think this is a good move on the part of this leadership team to acknowledge that our young people are literally ready, willing, and able to help us improve this district. So,
yeah, Mr. President, I'll just say, too, on 629, you know, this is how a lot of young people get their leadership, too. You know, I mean, you met Challenge Against Violence.
Right.
By getting involved in things like this at a very young age. So I'm a big supporter of that. The other thing I want to add, too, is I know that there were some folks who are kind of concerned about all the things from the special committees. And I think it's important to point out that it's better to do it right and take the things that we can do now and do them. I don't know if you said this, Mr. President, or not, but if everything isn't done this year or during this budget cycle, doesn't mean that it can't be revisited in 6 months or whatever. I would just urge people that,
you would rather have it done right than done quickly. And 629, I think, represents what I always call, as the superintendent calls it, board president calls it, kind of like low-hanging fruit. This is something that can be done that's kind of budget neutral and can move on. But I don't want people to think that all of the ideas that came out of the special committee that they're just being cast aside. I think it's important to prioritize and do what we can do right, and then look at some of the other things over a longer period of time just to make sure that it's happening. And I think 629 is an example of something that's what we call low-hanging fruit that can be done effectively and right in a short period of time. Some of the other stuff may take a little bit more time. And the last thing you want us is to have poor implementation. I mean, look at East High School. We're being forced to do that fast. We don't want to do things fast and not do it correctly. So I just wanted to point that out.
Mr. Cruz? I think 629 is another example of having to be careful, too, as we implement things, that we don't impact other things. And I had one concern because it was voiced to me with regard to how the Youth Council will impact Sophie's leadership group. And I was assured that they're going to be separate and there is very distinct clarity in terms of purpose. But again, as we look at some of these recommendations, even our own, we have to sort of reconcile them with current policy or current ways of operating and making sure that we don't do something and then, you know, maybe impact something else negatively. So I think it's good that we're taking the time. And there are some great suggestions that are coming out of the committees. And I think people feel good that a number of them are going to see themselves in this year's budget. So I think that speaks to the group and the work they've been doing.
Yeah, so actually following up on that point of, being careful and conscious of how we affect existing policy and existing efforts and initiatives, the relationship between 628 and 629 I want to address briefly. 628 refers to the retaining high scope as the pre-K curriculum. And when Commissioner Paul and I were collaborating on the development of that resolution, I actually had drafted a companion resolution and I circulated it with colleagues, but then I withdrew that resolution and it had called for a reconsideration of the K-2 curriculum. I don't know if Jackie Cady is still here, but it basically spoke to her. I mean, it was coincidental, but it actually really directly addressed exactly what she was saying, calling for us to really examine what we have in this district in terms of resources and local high standards for early education that's developmentally appropriate, that has appropriate content, that can be a much richer resource for our children than the core knowledge instructional framework in K-2. But what I, my thought process was that there is a lot going on with teaching and learning. It makes more sense, I think, to build some of these structures, and the Youth Instructional Council is specifically geared toward curriculum advisory capacity, looking at curriculum and pedagogy, making sure that our youth have an input into affecting the curriculum. So it is distinct from a general, the importance is acknowledged of a general youth leadership council, but this is very specific. And it goes hand in hand with the other recommendations that were offered by that student achievement special committee that you convened, President White, which involves the social justice office and an instructional change person. So those three things hand in hand will offer the support and the leadership over a deliberate, meaningful process, I believe, to get to the kind of curriculum improvement that was intended behind the companion resolution, but that I think with a deliberate, collaborative, really thoughtful process we can get to. So I want to support both of these resolutions and say that I think I'm really optimistic that we're going in a good direction building.
Commissioner Adams, do you envision moving that companion resolution forward and on what kind of timeline?
I realize that you were advising that it should be offered this evening. You're anxious for that timeline. I wish that we were ready and able as a district to embrace that, but I don't think we are, and I think that we have to see how well we can build these other processes.
Absolutely.
Do you see it going to a committee in the meantime, or?
I think it is appropriate for it to go through the Excellence in Student Achievement Committee. Certainly, it's coming from a lot of work that's been done in the ad hoc committee, but that's not the same as a fully constituted, you know, with three board members vetting through the board process. So it's fully appropriate for it to go through Excellence and Student Achievement Committee as well. But I see it as a longer, possibly longer, more complicated process than just that, too.
I think that does it for the discussion, but let me just say, Commissioner Evans and Commissioner Cruz, I think you're absolutely right, and Commissioner Evans, I had not said that before. If you look at Facebook, I think some people are disappointed that everything isn't happening at one time. Well, I want to say just be happy, but I understand the impatience and the frustration, but if we're going to do things right, we have to be deliberative, we have to make sure that we're not doing things that are only going to last for a short period of time. So I think you are right on time to explain that to people. Some of these things will have to go to committee, will have to be vetted to make sure they're the right thing. The administration has, of course, the right, and it's essential that they chime in these conversations. So as Commissioner Evans said, though, this particular initiative was low-hanging fruit. It's budget neutral, and as Commissioner Adams says, much of the other recommendations can and should flow from this. Some of the conversation about those other things that have to be vetted can come from that. So thank you all for your comments. Any further discussion? There being no further discussion, all those in favor of resolution 620 through 634, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Madam Clerk, any nays? The ayes have it. Moving on to unfinished business, there is none. New business, Commissioner Cruz, do you want to just, these are just information discussion items, yes. Policies?
Yeah, just the information is there, so if you have any questions, let us know. But it's some of it, a little bit of tweaking as we go through, and, you know, as council looks at these and reviews those, we want to make sure that we're, the kind of stuff that comes out of the state that we're including in our policies and things like that. So we're tweaking them as we're going along, but a lot of them are just some technical changes.
All these, of course, come from good listening, but I would just specifically draw folks' attention to the proposed revision of suspected child abuse policy, number 4560. Thank you, Mr. Lopez, of course, Mr. Cruz, and everybody who worked on that particular policy. That was in response to concerns that people were having and expressing, and we listened and took a lot of work on Ed and Bethany's part. I think they did a lot of work on that, so we appreciate your good work. Speakers on the agenda, we've already covered that. Our next meeting, a special meeting, is a budget adoption, is May the 8th at 6 p.m. Our next business meeting, it says, is April. That's wrong. She's working so hard. We got the wrong day. May 27th. May 27th, that will be at 6, right? Because we'll have a cookies, commissioners, and conversation. And then, am I right on that, Madam Clerk? Give me the date one more time.
May
22nd at 6 o'clock. We got to get one of these commissioners online to do the playlist and to do the robocall, but we'll take care of that. And then, of course, all this stuff is available on the Rochester Board's webpage at www.rcsdk12.org for additional meeting information. Can I get a motion to adjourn?
Into executive session.
Into executive session. Thank you for reminding me. that motion has been seconded. So we're going to adjourn into executive session. Let me tell you all, we're going downstairs, and we will be adjourning once we come out of executive session from downstairs. Thank you very much. Have a nice night.
You guys do this when scandal was on.
Oh, yeah, right.